The Bible reads, 1 John chapter 1, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and shew unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. This then is the message which we have heard of him, and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ his Son cleanseth us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Father, I thank you, God, for this word. I thank you for this portion of Scripture. I pray, God, that you would use it, and you'd get all the glory for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
1 John chapter 1. 1 John chapter 1. This passage begins with the that. And that I have color-coded in my Bible in purple. And that's like a royal color to me quite often in the Scriptures. That is pointing to the very last words of that same first verse, the word of life. That which was from the beginning... it's the word of life. Well, how do we know that? Well, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. If you turn to John chapter 1, you'll see in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then here in 1 John, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, of the word of life. I want to talk about joy through Jesus today. Joy through Jesus. And the reference here and these passages of Scripture fall in place very simply because I believe it was intended to do so. The Apostle John begins with that great in the beginning, pointing back to Genesis chapter 1. And here we have the next epistle that he writes, pointing back to the same beginning, the same creation, the same foundation of everything that the Apostle John is about to speak about. In the beginning, God created. In the beginning was the Word was with God. And by extension, I believe, and by application, what we have here, the Word of Life being connected with God the Creator, being connected with God the Word in John chapter 1, is one and the same. It's pointing us to the revelation of God as the Creator. It's pointing us to the revelation of God as the living Word. It's pointing us to now as the Word of Life, the Word that gives life. John chapter 1, we know it says, the Word was with God, the Word was God, and it continues on, it says, the Word was made flesh, but also by extension and by application, I see in this portion of Scripture that it's the heard Word, it's the seen and looked upon Word, it's the handled Word, yes, for the Apostle John, who leaned upon the Lord's breast, who had intimacy with the Lord, right? He could hug on him, he could shake his hand, he could pat him on the back, and he was patted on the back by the Lord. What a great experience, what a great opportunity that the Apostle John had. But we don't have that same blessing, but we have the more sure word, in fact. We have the word of life, we have the Bible, we have the living word that we live by, essentially. Man doesn't live by bread alone. How does a man stay sustained for 40 days and 40 nights without food? On the word of life, on the word of God, that's how. The word of life is what man lives by, not by bread only. And so here, though we haven't in person seen the flesh of the Lord, we haven't beheld him, we haven't handled him, we haven't looked upon him in person, we have the same experience available to us through the words of life contained within the King James Bible. That's verse 1. In verse 2, we see the parentheses here talking about that life. For the life was manifested. We have seen it. And bear witness and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. Now the word of life is being highlighted in this parentheses as something that was manifested and then shown unto others. It is the eternal life. It is the word of God. It is the believer's passage to eternal life, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Hearing by the life, the word of life. And this parenthesis talks about how it was manifested. Manifested means it was made plain. It was given in clarity. It was shown unto those, and it was received and it was understood as that eternal life that was with the Father and yet was manifested unto us. Again, pointing to the Word in John chapter 1. The Word that was with God, was God, and was manifested unto the Apostle John is that same Word, that eternal life, that life of the Word of God, the Word of life, which the Apostle John is now portraying unto those within this parenthesis. We know in Genesis chapter 1, in verse 20, Genesis chapter 1 and verse 20, God said, "Let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life, and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven." We see life then given to the fowls, given to the living creatures there, and they have a form of life. But if you look over in verse 26, it says, "And God said, let us make man in our image." Now this is different. This is special. This is something that God purposely, after he had made all of the life and the beasts in the field and the fowls of the air and the cattle and the creeping things after his kind, he said, "It is good, but let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth in the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. A special place given for mankind were that they would oversee. They would have dominion over all of the creation that had happened to date, only one day later. But then you see there across the page in verse 7 of chapter 2, the Lord God, this is another version or another point of view of that same creation story, and how it wasn't just let us make man in our image and it was like that. How the God actually, it says in verse 7, the Lord God formed man of the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So we see here that what is received in man is a living soul, separate, distinct, special compared to all the other living creatures. Though they had life, though they were given life, though they were birthed by the voice of God, by the word of God, and created to go forth and multiply and replenish the earth in that same reproductive fashion that man was given, and the same command that man was given to go forth and to replenish, to bring forth life, to bring forth life, to bring forth life after their kind. But very specifically, God says here, he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. He became a living soul. The Bible says that man became a living soul with that breath of life. So here the life is manifested to us, but we weren't there in the Garden of Eden. We weren't there when this was revealed. And yet we can behold it, we can taste it, we can see and we can look upon, we can handle that same word of life because we have, by faith, received the word of God. We can open it, we can behold it, we can go back, we can image, we can picture what's happening here. But that word of life isn't necessarily something that we did in person, but that word of life is something, yes, that which was from the beginning, but now we can receive it. How do we receive that same thing? Well, the same way it was manifested unto us. So Jesus says, and if you go back to our passage, we're going to be there in John chapter 1, or 1 John. So let's just stay there. In John chapter 1 and verse 3, the Bible says, "All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men." So the light of men was, in fact, this actual light, was this life that God had given unto him. Jesus said specifically that, "I am the light." We know that Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." In Matthew chapter 5, he turned this around and said, "Ye are the light of the world." Look in verse 3 of 1 John. It says, "That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ." The purpose then that this would be portrayed, that this light, that this life, this eternal life would be shown forth, was to this end, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And that is important. It is good to have fellowship with the Apostle John, with the believers at that time. It's good to have fellowship one with another. But he says specifically here, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. The purpose of the Word of Life being manifested was that there would be fellowship. And this is a great truth that we see, again, carried through those scriptures. When we go back to Genesis, we find God walking with Adam in the cool of the day. We find God fellowshipping one-on-one with Adam. And then the same purpose carries through to the New Testament, where Jesus Christ comes in his incarnate state and walks with man. He dwelt among us, the Bible says. And now to the end, way back here in history, 100 AD or somewhere in therein, he says, we have seen and declare these same truths. We have, in our case, read and declare these same truths to the purpose that ye may have fellowship with us. This is why we go soul winning. We go out that these would have fellowship with us. But truly, and truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And that's paramount. And that's the most important thing. So Jesus said, I am the light, right? The word of life, the light of the world. But ye are the light. And in that same way, we're to go forth and share that eternal life. We're to share the life that was manifested. We're to share the very words of life as we go forth and as we reach people and as we walk into people. This same truth needs to be declared. These truths that are seen and heard declare we unto you. And the Apostle John here says, these things have I seen and heard, and I declare them unto you. Well, how do we do this? We go and we teach. We go and we preach. And the same thing is happening here. The purpose then, as it reads down, is that there may be fellowship. And the next thing that we see is that, verse 4, there may be fullness of joy. And these things write we unto you that your joy may be full. So we see right in the beginning pages, right in the beginning four verses, the purpose that the Apostle John is writing. The reason why he is writing this epistle is that he would manifest forth the word of life, and that those which hear what he has seen and is now declaring would have fellowship with us, would have fellowship with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ, and would have joy that is full, would have fullness of joy. And this is going to be the theme as we walk through the epistle of 1 John. What do we do then? The same thing the Apostle John is here. How do we write? How do we get this same message out? How do we get people to hear the word of life, to receive that eternal life, to have fellowship with us, to have fellowship with the Father, to have fullness of joy in that order? How do we get that to happen? Well, we declare the message. The exact same thing the Apostle John's here. Though he penned it and though he set it forth that it would be an epistle that would be read by many, we too can have the epistle of our lives on display for all. We can have the epistle of our words on display for all. We can be that plain epistle as we go about, we preach, we teach, we walk about this world, that will give people the call to fellowship, that will give people the call to fullness of joy. We need to take that same message. This then is the message which ye have heard of him and declare unto you, which we have heard of him and we declare unto you, is that message of the word of life. Foundationally, we need to determine to know nothing among the people that we go to save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Because that's the foundation. You can't have joy in the Christian life if you're not in the Christian life. You can't have joy, fullness of joy, unless you've entered into the fellowship of the Father and of the Son. And that fellowship is entered into through salvation. Once you're saved, you enter into that fellowship. But more so, the Apostle John isn't just writing here to try to get people saved. I believe his primary audience here is those that are already saved, and his purpose is that there would be an established fellowship and there would be a fullness of joy. And those things are synonymous. If you have fellowship with God, you are full of joy of the Holy Ghost, rejoicing in the Spirit, the Bible says. So as we go, yes, determined to foundationally get people to believe, that they would have fellowship with us as we speak to them and minister unto them, and we're one-on-one with them, and we're trying to provoke them to call upon the Lord. We're trying to lead them the Romans road. We're trying to take them the path that will bring them unto God, where they will repent of their unbelief and turn to the living God and ask Him for salvation and receive it. And then they enter into that fellowship where they can then begin to have that fullness of joy grow up in them. Jesus Christ is the life. He is the light. He is the whom that this fellowship is with. It's not important that there have that the people of this world have fellowship with me. It's not important or paramount or the most important thing that they have fellowship with this church. The most important thing is that they have fellowship with Jesus, that they have fellowship with the Father, that they are united, kindred spirits with the Father, and then after that they can have fellowship with us. After that we can be united. And so our purpose isn't just as some to just go and invite people out to church and go and try to fill this house. No, our purpose is that there would be fellowship and fullness of joy. And the ones that are here now, those of us that are here now, can have fellowship and fullness of joy. And honestly, that is paramount. And that is the most important reason why I believe the Epistle of John is being written here. We often read that verse, "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God." And if you've ever wondered why there's two believes there, it's because the people believe, but they need to believe. There's a fullness of your faith. There's a fullness of your belief on God. And though you've trusted in Jesus to save your soul, and though that verse is great to get people to understand that they may know that they have eternal life, quite often we kind of leave it as a dot, 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 because it reiterates the same truth, that you may believe on the name of the Son of God, and that you may believe, right? You may believe. Well, that's because it's almost the next step. It's the next level of understanding. It's the next level of fellowship is when you believe God, but then you believe Him. You believe God to save you, but now you believe Him to sanctify you. You believe Him to take you to heaven when you die, but now you believe Him to help you through your trials, your tribulations, your struggles. Amen. It's that next step of faith. The Apostle John here isn't just writing so that people would get saved. That's why the Gospel of John was written, to get people to believe on Jesus, to get them to understand the gospel truth. This is more so to the believer already, that they would believe, that they would have the fullness, that they would have the fellowship. Jesus is the life. Jesus is the light. And that joy in Jesus comes through what He did on the cross. How do we have joy in the Christian life? Is it just about ramping up our emotions? Is it just about being excited? Is it just about having feelings? Is it just about running around the aisles? No, joy in the Christian life comes from obedience to the words of life. Joy in the Christian life comes from giving yourselves wholly unto these truths. Joys in the Christian life come from taking the word of life that is manifested unto you and then living that eternal life. We all receive eternal life when we believe and trust on Christ, but do we believe that eternal life to work through us, to work in us, to give us the fullness of joy as we have fellowship with the Father? That's the next steps in the Christian life. This is a deep book, and it talks about deep truths and gives us understandings of what it means to truly love, what it means to truly be united with, what it means to be truly yoked up with the Father through the Son, and so that the Christian can have fullness of joy, the Christian can move on to higher ground, the Christian can grow in grace in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. This book is there to that end. It's not just a little baby Christian book. This book is so much more than that. I'm praying God would open up my understanding of this even as I read it. It's so profound, this passage of Scripture. The message then is this, verse 5. "This then is the message which ye have heard of Him, which we have heard of Him and declare unto you, that God is light and in Him is no darkness at all." God is light, in Him is no darkness at all. He is the very embodiment. He is full of, He is in entirety light. There is no darkness at all in the Lord. We know of the light that it shineth in darkness. It says that in the next verse. It says, "It shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehendeth it not." That's in John chapter 1. "The light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not." So what happens when light turns on into a room? The darkness can't grasp it. It can't encompass it. It can't absorb it. The darkness simply has no choice but to remove. And so light shines in, darkness must move out. God moves in, and darkness has no place and must go. And that's the truth about having fellowship with God, is that when God, when light, when truth enters in, there is no place for darkness. And this is where this passage of Scripture starts to take on these statements that we look at, and they seem kind of contradictory. They seem as if it's saying that a Christian no longer sins, or is just incapable of sin, or is just completely impeccable in that way. But the reality is that there's a choice that needs to be made. And the choice starts to line itself plainly when we see that there's statements made that say, well, if we say. So God has just said that this is the message. The Apostle John says, this is the message. This is the most important message that needs to go out in this first portion of this scripture. And that is, God is light and in him is no darkness at all. So what does that mean? Well, it means this in verse 6. It means that if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. So therefore, if someone's saying, I have fellowship, I am close to, I am united with, I have common ground with, I'm very familiar with, I have a friendly association, me and God are like this, we are close. God understands me, I understand God. If someone says that they have fellowship with Christ, if they say they have fellowship with God, if they say that they have fellowship with the light and walk in darkness, they're lying and do not the truth. The Bible is very clear here, but you are actually walking in darkness. There is no middle ground here. Light comes in, we know, we turn the light on, the darkness goes away, except for where the shadows are, except for where it's concealed from the light. He is light, and if you're walking with the light, it's clear there's no place for darkness. If we are walking in darkness, that is the opposite of walking with God. And since he is light, if we are walking in darkness, we're not lying. We're not doing the truth. We're not performing that which is appropriate, that which is right for someone who says they have fellowship with him. Again, it starts to sound like we're preaching like sinless perfectionism or something like that. But the reality is that, again, there's free will. There's choices that need to be made in this area. God's desire is that we would hear the message. We would hear the great truth that God is light. The next part of God's message is that we would have fellowship with him and that we would have fullness of joy. And so the charge here is made, the comparison here is made that if we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in darkness, we're lying, we're not doing the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. So here's the difference here, is that when we are walking in darkness, we don't fellowship with God. When our direction, when our path, when our purpose, when our goals, when everything about us is to walk towards darkness, is to walk in darkness, we don't have fellowship with God. We're not doing the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from our sin. So here's the choice we have to make. Do we walk in darkness, or do we walk in light? Again, it's like, okay, is he just preaching that we have to be sinless, without spot, with blameless? No, because it continues on as we see, if we walk in the light, what's happening? The blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. So now you see that there is somebody who is purposed, motivated, desiring to, even a believer, walk in darkness. And then there's also the person that is purposed, desiring to, wanting to walk with God. And his end is that as he walks with God, he has fellowship with God, and the active agent in cleansing from sin, the blood of Jesus Christ, enters in and cleanses him from all sin. So there's the crux of the matter. There's the difference of the matter. This is a command because there is a choice to be made. We need to walk in the light. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. So if we're walking in the light, what did we learn that was? Well, that's the life. God is light. The word of life, the word is God. All these things go together. That breath of life that entered into man, that Spirit of God that is available unto men, is the light, is the life, is available for us to walk in. But what happens when you're doing that? Well, when you're in the light, very quickly you see, well, there's some shadows being cast. There's some darkness in these regions. There's some things that are hidden. Light is coming down upon me, and yet what light is doing is it is revealing that there is, in fact, darkness. Look at this. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sins. Verse 9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So as we walk in the light and we see that there is darkness upon us, that there is darkness concealed in our hearts, that there is darkness in our actions, in our motives, if we confess them, and the Bible says that confession is the opposite of, or confession means to deny not. When you're confessing something, you're denying not. And some people will often ask, you know, what does it mean to confess the Lord Jesus? How does that bring salvation? I like John chapter 1 and verse 20. It says, and he confessed and denied not, but confessed that I am not the Christ. So there we're sandwiched between in the same context. Confession is linked with denying not. So if we confess Jesus with our mouth, what it means is we're not denying him. We are confessing that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. And when we confess that outwardly, it just means simply we're not denying him. That's what happens at the point of salvation. So if we confess our sins, in other words, if we don't deny our sins, it says God here is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And verse 7 and verse 9 kind of go together and are that full picture of what it means to have fellowship with Jesus Christ. It means that you're walking in the light. In other words, the light of the Word is shining into your life. And as it shines into your life, you confess your sins. As the light comes upon you and shows you that you're proud, it shows you that you have anger, it shows you that you have bitterness, you confess those sins. And when you're walking in the light and you're confessing your sins, the Bible says here that the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, is there to cleanse you. It says here that he is faithful and just to forgive your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So this is the difference between the person that is a liar walking in darkness and the person that is in righteousness walking in the truth. They are walking in a direction that has them yoked up with God to the end, to the purpose that they would be in fellowship and there would be a constant cleansing happening in their life. The blood of Jesus Christ available at a whim for when you slip up, available at a moment's notice for when you slip up. God giving his own faithfulness unto you that he will forgive, he will cleanse as you walk with him. But there's this choice that needs to be made. We need to walk in light or we need to walk in darkness. The Bible says if we say that we have fellowship, but we say we have no sins, or we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar. Verse 8, if we say that we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. Verse 10 says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. I believe that verse 10 is pointing to somebody who's not even saved because the word not in them. They're making God a liar. They're treading upon the sacrifice of Jesus Christ again, I guess, putting him open to shame. So either you're saying you have fellowship, but also saying you have no sin and you have not sinned and you're in a dire strait. You're in darkness. You're lying. You're not doing the truth. Or what I think we should be and we should desire to attain to, we should desire to be in, and that is in fellowship with God. And fellowship with God comes from walking in the light. So you can either say you have fellowship or you can walk in the light and have fellowship. You got a choice to make. Either we're going to have a religion where we're just talking, we're just saying, I do this, I do that, I am this, I am that. I give tithes of all that I possess. We have a suit on. We're in church every Sunday. We're either going to talk about how we have fellowship. We're going to say we have fellowship, which leads, I believe, in a direction to eventually saying in self-righteousness that I have no sin. I'm not guilty. We well up with pride and nobody can tell us that we're wrong. We think that we're better than everybody else in this religious fervor, in this pharisaical mindset that indwells the person. Either we say we have fellowship and we go down a trail that leads us to being liars, that leads us to being false, that leads us to being phony, that leads us to being religious zealots that are getting nothing done, that have no fellowship, no relationship with the God that saved him. Either we're saying something or we're doing something. And what we're doing as Christians that is right is walking in the light. If we are walking in the light, if we are confessing and not denying our sins, then that residual, that ongoing, that immediate availability, that faithful and just forgiveness, that blood cleansing agent, that blood bath that comes upon us is available for us all the time. Why? Because we're walking with God. We're walking in the truth. Our new man is just constantly in communion with God. The Holy Spirit working in our lives. We're reading the Word. We're letting it change us. And when it does, and when we're at fault, the soft heart, the heart that is in love with the Lord, the heart that is in the Word of life, that has eternal life, not just to take them to heaven, but eternal life residing in somebody's soul to bring them to the next steps in Christianity. When we are in that constant communion with God, then as soon as we slip up, as soon as we sin, as soon as we falter and fall from the truth, as soon as we sin against the Lord, as soon as we break a commandment, the cleansing agent is right there waiting for you. Because you are determined, you are set in your ways that you are going to have fellowship with God. And this is how people get backslidden. Because they go from actually having fellowship with God, actually having the light of the Word, like we talked about today, through reading of the Bible, through letting that cleansing, washing agent work in our lives. You go from reading the Word, confessing your faults. And this is what happens when you're a newborn baby Christian. I found that very quickly. I was finding out things were sins that weren't sins. And some of the things you're able to put out of your life very quickly. Oh, that's a sin? Okay, I can stop doing that. That's a sin? Oh, I have to stop doing that. But we get to a point where we think we've got it figured out. We start to think that we are good. We are better. We have made it. The Apostle Paul said, I have not attained. And so who are we as believers now to think that we have somehow attained? Now, we need to have that ongoing fellowship. Not walking in darkness, not saying that we have reached some religious level, but we need to walk with God, walk in the light, have fellowship with God. And when we do sin, we confess them. When we do fall short of God's glory, which we all have, we confess Him, we're cleansed immediately by the blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible is clear that if we say that we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves. The truth is not in us. And how often do we find people that are religious that say, oh, I have no sin? And how often do we ourselves, in moments of pride, when somebody catches us, when somebody says, hey, you said this, instead of going, you're right, I'm wrong. You know, in the relationships of life, we fight and say, no, I didn't do that. I didn't mean that. We have some sort of excuse. That's just like us saying we have no sin. We're deceiving ourselves. The reality is that we sin nearly every moment of our lives in some way, shape, or form, because the thought of foolishness is sin. But in turn, in the opposite direction, we need to walk in the light. We need to have fellowship with Christ. We need to have His blood cleansing agent at our beck and call, ready to cleanse us at any particular moment, confessing our sins, not denying them, not saying, no, I didn't do that, not always trying to find a way to get the guilt off of yourself. And that's such a wrong attitude, and I'm guilty of it all the time. You know, if your boss calls you out at work and just says, you know what, you messed up, don't be the guy that's like, well, this happened, and so-and-so didn't do this, and he should have done that, and this wasn't... No, we're just putting blame away. We're just putting fault away. What we're doing, and we carry that same attitude over towards God, is that we are saying that we have no sin. We're deceiving ourselves. But the Christian that, like we talked about, the Christian that has the Bible first thing in the morning, that's always in the Bible, that always has the Word of life available to them, that's hearing it, that's meditating upon it, walking with God, walking in the truth, when someone comes at you and says, hey, you've sinned, you say, I confess. I'm not denying that. You're absolutely right, I've sinned. I'm wrong in so many ways. Forgive me. You know what's there waiting for you? Forgiveness. It'll help you in your personal life. It'll help you in your professional life. It'll help you in the relationships that you're trying to build. If you are just quick to confess your sins. Confess your faults, even to a fault. Even when you take blame for things that weren't even your fault. God's going to reward that because you're seeking to please Him. You're seeking to walk in the light day by day, moment by moment, with the blood of Jesus Christ available to you, with His faithfulness, His justice, His righteousness, just available to be imputed unto you because you're softened. Because you're ready to confess, because you're ready to forsake the sin. And it only comes because of that word of life, which was manifested unto us, which called us into His grace, which we were saved thereby, because then from there we seek to have fellowship with Him. We want to have joy. And that's what we'll see as we go on, is that that constant intimacy with Christ brings joy. And so, as we read through this, we're going to see either you're walking in darkness, you're a liar, you don't know the truth, or you're walking in light, you have fullness of joy, and you have great fellowship with the Father. This is a book that is meant for Christian living, and I pray, God, that You help me as I walk through this passage and help all of us to walk in the light as He is in the light and have fellowship with Him. It'll give us power in our life. It'll give us strength in His life. God will be glorified in this life. Our family will benefit from us. You know, sometimes the more we will love others, the less we will be loved. But there's joy even in that because Christ suffered those same things. And there's another step of fellowship that we can have with Him, is the fellowship of His sufferings.